Are you an instrument pilot, or have you thought about getting an instrument rating someday? Are you sometimes confused about whether to load an approach with vectors or to load it with an IAF? And have you ever been told that you should always load an approach with an IAF, even if you're receiving vectors to final? Well, it turns out that's not always the best advice, and if you stick around, I'll tell you why. Hello, my name is Max Truscott. I've been flying for 50 years. I'm the author of several books and the 2008 National Flight Instructor of the Year. And my mission is to help you become the safest possible pilot. And if you're new to this show, take a moment right now and touch either the subscribe key or, if you're using the Apple Podcast app, the follow key so that next week's episode is downloaded for free. And if you didn't hear last week's episode, in which I talked about the fatal crash of a Cirrus SR-22T in Indiana and why the CAPS parachute matters, you may want to check it out at aviationnewstalk.com/303. Coming up in the news the week of November 27th, 2023, accidents are up, but the accident rate is down. An airline employee is charged with carrying a gun through a TSA checkpoint, and a drone pilot was sentenced, and we'll tell you what he did. All this and more, and the news starts now. From generalaviationnews.com, accidents up in 2021, but an increase in flight hours creates a downward trend. A new report from AOPA's Air Safety Institute shows that the number of GA accidents rose in 2021, but an increase in flight hours helped mitigate increases in accidents. Quote, the overall total and fatal accident rates for 2021 continued trending downward, with a total accident rate of 4.28 per 100,000 hours and a fatal accident rate of 0.77 per 100,000 hours, according to the report. A large increase in flight activity helped mitigate increases in accidents. Overall flight activity rose from 22.4 million hours in 2020 to 26.4 million hours in 2021. The 33rd edition of the report was renamed from the Joseph T. Nall Report to the Richard McSpadden Report to honor McSpadden, who lost his life in an aircraft accident October 1st in Lake Placid, New York. The new report includes data from 2021, as it takes the NTSB approximately 2 years to issue a probable cause. The report notes an increase in total accidents from 1,050 in 2020 to 1,124 in 2021, including 202 fatal accidents. However, 4 million additional flight hours, compared to the previous year, helped offset the increase in accidents. Overall accident rates decreased from 4.69 per 100,000 hours to 4.28, while the fatal accident rate decreased from 0.84 to 0.77 from 2020 to 2021. According to the report, stall/loss-of-control events continued to be the leading causal factor, and weather-related accidents remained highly lethal. Robert Geske, AOPA Air Safety Institute Manager of Aviation Safety Analysis, said, quote, an area where we see some discouragement is the non-commercial helicopter accident rate, which rose following 2 years of decline. We're also disappointed to see the lethality rate for weather accidents remain steady at an average of 8 per year, despite continual efforts to address this area. The percentage of pilot-related accidents remained around 70%. Pilot-related accidents totaled 647 total, of which 103 were fatal. Landing accidents still accounted for the largest number, 209, but thankfully suffered few fatal accidents, just 9 according to the report. Loss of control, 147, continued to dominate as the leading cause of landing accidents. Takeoff and climb accidents, 119, fell from the previous year. The largest number of accidents were loss of control, followed by stall or settled on takeoff. Fuel management, 70, rose slightly from the previous year. And we'll have a link to the full report in our show notes. From avweb.com, aircraft sales up across the board. In its quarterly report on GA shipments and billings, the General Aviation Manufacturers Association, or GAMA, said all sectors were up, sometimes by double digits, both in terms of shipment numbers and their value in the first three quarters of the year compared to 2022. Percentage-wise, piston helicopters led the pack with a 15.3% increase on 158 units. Turboprops were a close second with a 14.6% increase, and sales totaled 439. Piston airplane sales were up 11.9% with 1,135 deliveries, and turbine helicopters jumped 6.3% with 469 units. Business aircraft sales were up 2%, and the overall average was 10.1% increase in sales. Total billings increased from $14.1 billion to $14.5 billion. Airline employee charged after loaded gun found in carry-on bag at MSP. A Buffalo, Minnesota man who works for an airline was charged after a loaded gun was discovered earlier this month in his carry-on bag at Minneapolis-St. Paul International, according to the TSA and police. The article doesn't say what kind of work the person did for the airline, but the mugshot clearly shows that he's in a first officer's uniform. And I should point out that pilots and other airline employees can go through an expedited type screening in which they don't have the same amount of screening that the general public does. Continuing on, the article says TSA discovered the firearms at the South Security Checkpoint in Terminal 1 just after 5 p.m. after the employee was randomly selected for additional screening. MSP Airport Police responded to the checkpoint after a TSA officer detected the image of a handgun on an X-ray screen during the screening. Airport Police subsequently charged Jordan Aloysius Carlson, 22, with presenting a prohibited item at checkpoint screening. Carlson was booked and released, and police said the investigation was ongoing. While TSA described Carlson as an airline employee, police didn't identify his employer. From aeronews.net, final NTSB report on a Falco F8L, which is an Italian-designed, lightweight, two-seat aerobatic aircraft. The report says the pilot performed a pre-flight inspection before he initiated the startup and taxi without any anomalies noted. During the initial climb after takeoff, about 100 feet above the ground, an engine compartment access cover opened. The pilot called ATC and was cleared to land on a parallel runway. The pilot continued in the traffic pattern, but slowed the airplane in hopes that the access cover would not detach. The pilot became focused on the open cover and let the airspeed decrease, which resulted in a buffet, the left wing dropping, and the airplane, quote, falling out of the sky. The airplane subsequently impacted a taxiway and came to rest on the parallel runway, resulting in substantial damage to the fuselage and left wing. The pilot reported that there were no pre-impact mechanical malfunctions or failures of the airplane that would have precluded normal operation. He also stated that he was, quote, focused way too much on the open engine cover and way too little on flying the airplane. The result was a classic stall spin scenario, too close to the ground. Probable cause, the pilot's failure to maintain airplane control after an engine access cover opened during the initial climb. From YouGov.com, how confident are you that you could safely land a passenger airplane in an emergency situation, replying only on the assistance of air traffic control? Now, this comes from a survey of 20,063 U.S. adults, and nearly half of one demographic feels confident that they could land an airliner with just the help of ATC. I'll let you think about what group that might be, and I'll give you a hint. The survey is broken up by region of the U.S., gender, politics, age, and race. So which group do you think is most confident? First, let me tell you that overall, only 13% of the population is confident they could land a plane, and 19% is somewhat confident. So 32%, or nearly a third of everyone surveyed, figures that, hey, yeah, they could land an airliner if needed. To which I say, baloney. If we look at this by region, 37% of the people surveyed in the West figured they could pull off this feat, while only 25% in the Midwest think they could do it. Now let's look at gender. Do you think there are any differences between men and women on this question? Just 20% of women are very confident or somewhat confident they could land the airliner, while a whopping 46%, or nearly half of all men, are either very confident or somewhat confident they could land an airliner by themselves, which at least in this case shows that women are smarter on this topic than men. And we never talk about politics on this show, but I think you'll be interested to know that Democrats and Republicans had virtually identical percentages that they were confident or very confident they could land an airliner on their own. In other headline news, here's a story we talked about in more detail on the Airplane Geeks podcast that I co-host. FedEx and UPS are offering buyouts to some of their pilots to leave these cargo airlines to go fly for American Airlines subsidiary PSA. Those pilots are being offered a $250,000 signing bonus and left seat jobs in Embraer and CRJ regional jets. So this is a sign that the cargo business is down since the pandemic. Cirrus Aircraft has installed a second SF-50 Vision Jet simulator at the Cirrus Aircraft Vision Center in Knoxville, Tennessee. Now, I saw the simulator as it was going in when I was at Cirrus a couple of months ago. This is going to help a lot as there are an increasing number of pilots who are type rated in the Vision Jet and who need to do annual recurrent training to keep their type rating active. EAA Chapter 983 at Pecan Plantation Airport in Texas just set a record. 31 of its members received Wright Brothers Master Pilots Award at a ceremony. To be eligible, Nominees must have 50 or more years of civil and military pilot experience, or 50 or more years combined experience in both piloting and aircraft operations. The effective start date for the 50 years is the date of the nominee's first solo flight, which means, and I can't believe this, I'll be eligible in a couple of days, as I soloed on December 1st in 1973. And from a preliminary NTSB report, a Cessna 150K November 6059 Gulf apparently had a stall spin accident this past September at the Huntsville Municipal Airport in Huntsville, Texas, which killed the CFI and student pilot. Two witnesses reported the plane was flying in a traffic pattern where they were on the ramp preparing for a flight when they heard a sudden decrease in engine RPM. They saw the airplane fly southbound over runway 18, about 500 feet above the ground, rocking its wings in a level pitch attitude. The airplane then entered a left nose-down turn. The CFI witness believed the pilot was attempting to make a 180-degree turn to land on runway 36. He stated that after the airplane turned about 90 degrees, it entered a spin and descended to the ground in a nose-down pitch attitude. And finally, from the eastbaytimes.com, California man gets 1 year probation for flying drone near gyrocopter, blimp, and Coast Guard copter. A Laguna Beach man in Southern California who flew a drone too close to a gyrocopter, a blimp advertising Shark Week, and a U.S. Coast Guard helicopter received 1 year of probation in federal court in Santa Ana on November 28th. Alexander Milinovic, 62, was handed the sentence after he agreed to plead guilty to three counts of unsafely operating an unmanned aircraft, all misdemeanors. U.S. District Judge Fred Slaughter also ordered Milinovic to pay a fine of $7,500 and to perform 120 hours of community service. The incidents with a gyrocopter and blimp both occurred last year. Milinovic was only charged this past May. That was after he flew his drone near the Coast Guard helicopter in March. The plea deal described what happened in each incident. On Father's Day 2022, a father and son took off in their gyrocopter from Chino Airport for a flight over the Pacific. They were flying off Laguna Beach when a small drone suddenly buzzed within 10 to 20 feet of their aircraft. The gyrocopter was 1.5 miles off the coast and 400 feet in the air when the pilot spotted the drone. With an open cockpit, they were worried the drone could have actually hit either of them, so they made an emergency maneuver to avoid the incoming drone. The next month, prosecutors said, a pilot on board the Discovery Channel Shark Week blimp was flying over the Pacific near Laguna Beach when Milinovic again flew his drone near the other aircraft. The blimp pilot said he spotted the drone zipping toward the midsection of the blimp, and he feared it actually hit his aircraft, piercing its outer envelope. The plea agreement did not say whether Milinovic actually hit the blimp, but the blimp was not forced to enter an emergency landing, as would have been required had the drone damaged it. Almost 1 year later, Milinovic flew his same drone near the U.S. Coast Guard helicopter. The Jayhawk rescue helicopter was also flying off the coast from Laguna Beach when the four Coast Guard members on board saw the drone near them. When the drone came within 200 feet of them, the helicopter pilots, quote, maneuvered the Jayhawk away from the drone out of concern that the drone would hit their tail rotor. FAA guidelines for drone pilots require them to fly their drones within their line of sight, and they must also fly their drones in a way that, quote, does not interfere with and gives way to any manned aircraft. Well, that's the news for this week. Coming up next, a few of my updates, and later we'll talk about the best ways to load an instrument approach when getting vectors to final. All right here on the Aviation News Talk Podcast. And now let's get to the good news. First, congratulations to mega supporter Miles Tedder. Now, the mega supporters are people who have signed up on Patreon to support us at the $50 a month level or higher, and they get a free book from me after 2 months. Miles writes, wanted to share with you that I passed my instrument check ride. Your podcast and guests have provided a wealth of knowledge, which was beneficial throughout the journey. I can only imagine the time and commitment it takes to produce your weekly episodes, but do want to let you know how very much they help someone like me. Keep up the good work, and I'll continue to look forward to each weekly episode. And congratulations to Jamie Neal. He's from the UK. He just passed his instrument conversion certificate here in the US. He's a client of mine. And if you're not familiar with the foreign conversions, let me just tell you briefly how that works. Jamie started with a private certificate in the UK, and then he went through the conversion process to get a U.S. license based on his foreign license. Now, that's a process that takes a good 45 days or longer. You start the process by going on to IACRA and filing an application, Paperwork then goes back and forth between the FAA and its counterpart in the other country to confirm that the certificates are valid. And then you're issued a certificate for the U.S. based on your foreign certificate. Now, here's the really interesting thing. Jamie flies an N-numbered aircraft in the U.K., so he needs a U.S. pilot certificate. He came over here on business, and he got his instrument rating here in the U.S., which attaches to his U.S. conversion certificate. And what he'll be able to do now is to convert that instrument rating that he took here in the U.S. back to his UK license through the same process in reverse. I'll include a link in the show notes in case you want to know more about that process. And since our main topic today is an instrument topic, let's talk about some other tidbits. Now, somebody posed a question, I think it was on Reddit, as to why the MEA for a T-route was higher than the MEA for a Victor Airway along the same path. And I didn't know the answer to that either. And hopefully you already know that Victor Airways guarantee terrain separation and guarantee reception of the navigation signal along that airway. Turns out that T-routes add one more guarantee, and that is two-way radio reception. And so that's why a particular T-route in Utah, I believe it was considerably higher because the T-route required two-way radio communication along the entire route, whereas the Victor Airway did not require that. And I came across an article in IFR magazine which talks about the requirements for the long cross-country when you're doing instrument training. And that requirement is for three different approaches. Now, what's been changing over the years is exactly what kinds of approaches those three different approaches have to be. And so it's a little bit confusing, and again, it's changed over the years. The article says that in March 2008, the FAA's Office of Chief Counsel issued the Glasser interpretation, which concluded that different kinds of navigation systems must be used and that pilots were to pick three from the list, NDB, LDA, VOR, GPS, SDF, and localizer, but it excluded ASR and PAR approaches. 10 years later, in February of 2022, the same office issued a memorandum to Flight Standards Service rescinding the prior interpretations. The change concludes that an applicant for an instrument rating only needs to conduct three kinds of approaches regardless of the navigation system used. So it means that technology is not a discriminator, but it introduces another point. It says different approaches can be defined by various lines of minimums found on an approach plate. But what does various lines of minimums mean? And the article has a number of different examples. But for example, something you couldn't have done in the past, you now can fly the same GPS approach one time to the LPV DA minimums and another time to LNAV minimums and possibly a third time to circling minimums. Likewise, you could fly both the localizer and the ILS for the same approach. So a lot more flexibility, and I'll include a link to the article in the show notes. And another question that sometimes comes up is, can I fly IFR in uncontrolled airspace without an IFR clearance? And the general answer to that is yes, but you don't want to do that taking off from an airport. Here is the LAM interpretation from the FAA, and it says, this letter responds to your November 6, 2015 request for a legal interpretation regarding IFR operations in Class G airspace. In your letter, you ask two questions, whether it is legal to fly under IFR in Class G airspace without a clearance, and whether it's legal to fly in IMC in Class G airspace without a clearance. You also ask a third question regarding whether a Part 121 or Part 135 proficiency check satisfies instrument recent flight experience for operations conducted under Part 91 or a flight review under Part 61. With respect to your first two questions, 14 CFR 91.173 requires an IFR flight plan and ATC clearance in controlled airspace, but is silent with respect to uncontrolled airspace. Per this regulation, and assuming an IFR-capable aircraft and pilot, it would also be permissible to fly in IMC without a clearance. However, 91.13 prohibits operating an aircraft in a careless or reckless manner, and the NTSB has previously ruled that under certain conditions, takeoff into clouds without an ATC clearance or release was extremely dangerous and in violation of 91.13. And I actually know of a case, I think it was in Indiana, where a pilot took off at a Class G airport and got violated because the clouds were below 1,000 feet, and the field was IFR. And earlier this week, NBAA put out a brochure called Reducing Runway Excursions in Business Aviation, and they also had a webinar on that topic. Both Rob Mark and I watched that. The 25-page document is excellent. During the webinar, one of the participants mentioned that anytime that he is given a lineup and wait instruction, that he immediately hacks the clock, which I think he means starts the clock. And he said that once a minute goes by, he questions whether he should still be sitting there in position and hold. Now, frankly, I think I would not wait for a full minute, probably be about 30 seconds before I would be on the radio with ATC asking if we should still be in position and hold. Of course, there has been at least one accident where one airliner landed on another airplane when that aircraft was left in position and hold, and the tower forgot about them being in that position. Now, the brochure says that runway excursions continue to be the leading cause of accidents in business aviation. In its 2022 safety report, the Flight Safety Foundation stated, quote, runway excursions were by far the most common accident type in corporate jet operations in 2022 and throughout the period under review. According to their statistics, in a review of accident types between 2017 and 2022, there were 79 runway excursions worldwide, which accounted more than the next two accident types combined, and nearly 41% of all accidents during that period. Of those 79 accidents, six were fatal, resulting in 18 total deaths. Now, most airlines and jet operators require that pilots go around if they do not have a stable approach. Yet, according to the Flight Safety Foundation's Go Around Decision Making and Execution Project from 2017, it says, interestingly and sadly, the collective industry performance of complying with go-around policies is extremely poor. Approximately 3% of unstable approaches resulted in go-around policy compliance. As an industry, we are doing a poor job of making the decision to go around when an approach clearly does not meet an operator's stabilized approach criteria, despite the fact that unstable approaches are the number one factor in runway excursions on landing. And they also talk about having management pilots flying on board. They say the primary challenge of flying as a line pilot assigned to a crew with a management pilot can best be described as blurring the lines of authority. This is especially true when the management pilot is acting as SIC, or second in command. The PIC may feel added pressure to follow the suggestions of the boss in the right seat, even when contrary to their own instincts. According to CBR data from the 2019 runway excursion and subsequent fire of Citation Latitude at 0 Alpha 9 or Elizabethton, Tennessee, the PIC and pilot flying appeared to recognize a visual approach did not meet stabilized approach criteria. And in the transcript, he queried the SIC, who was the chief pilot, if a go-around was warranted, to which the chief pilot simply replied, no. Would the PIC have made a different decision if he were not flying with a management pilot? And they also talk about Dr. Tony Kern's integrated model of professionalism, which includes being prepared, respectful, ethical, follow policies and procedures, leads by example, integrity, genuine, humble, and transparent. So this is a really excellent document, and I'll include a link to it in our show notes. And a day or two ago, I flew into the Hollister Airport with a pilot doing some instrument work, and it reminded me that back in October, I had been doing an instrument approach into Hollister, and I could tell from the traffic screen that there was a very fast CAL FIRE air attack aircraft flying in. This is one of the OV-10s, which flies at about 250 knots. It's a twin boom, a twin engine aircraft that's used for spotting and to call in the tankers for their fire retardant drops. And I could see the OV-10 coming in at about 250 knots and the lady pilot called that she was approaching the airport. And then I could see two tankers behind them. So obviously they were fighting some type of fire when we were working. So I broke off the approach. I figured, these people are working really hard. They've got a tough job to do. So there's just no point in continuing my instrument approach and to leave any doubt as to how we should integrate our approaches to the same runway. And after I broke off the approach, I heard somebody say, love the podcast. So whoever that was, thank you very much. And here's a note from Ed Waters. I think I mentioned Ed recently. He does a lot of training out at the Cirrus Vision Center, teaching new owners of Cirrus SR-20s and 22s how to use their new aircraft. And he said, just finished reading your Garmin G3000, G5000 book. Very well done. And I'm glad that a high-time pilot like Ed is finding my books helpful. So even if you know a lot about the G1000 or G3000 and the autopilot, there's probably more to learn. To truly master a plane, you have to master the avionics. So call now to get my Max Truscott's G1000 and Perspective Glass Cockpit Handbook or my G3000 and G5000 Handbook. Call now to order at 800-247-6553. And I just want to let you know that I'll be very close to LA for the next 2 weeks, December 3rd through the 15th, taking an aviation-related course that I'll tell you more about in a future show. And I do expect to have some free time, particularly on the weekend, December 9th and 10th. So if you have any recommendations on any particular aviation activity you think I might enjoy participating in while I'm there, please send me an email and pass along your recommendations. Now, I don't get to spend a lot of time on the ground in LA. Mostly, I'm flying in and out of airports there, so I rarely get to do anything when I'm there. So I look forward to your thoughts on this. And also, I want to mention that there's now an ad-free version of this show. It's been out for a couple months now, but this is the first time I'm mentioning it on the show. And in a moment, I'll tell you how you can get that version. Portions I cut out include me asking you to subscribe to the show by hitting the subscribe or follow key. I also cut out my invitation for you to support the show in the same way that so many other listeners are doing, which is to sign up and join the club to become a Patreon supporter. And I also cut out me talking about how much you could learn if you were to take time to buy one of my books and read them. And we may have some ads on the show in the future, and those will be cut out too. So how do you get the ad-free version? Well, it's really easy. All you have to do is go to aviationnewstalk.com/awesome and sign up at any dollar level to join our club and support the show. Now, Patreon recently introduced a, quote, free membership. Please don't sign up for that. I don't know why they did it. There's absolutely nothing you get by becoming a, quote, free member. And free members don't have access to the ad-free version of the show. So if you'd like to get the ad-free version, take a moment now to sign up at aviationnewstalk.com/awesome. Coming up next, we'll be talking about the best ways to load an instrument approach when you're receiving vectors to final. And after that, we'll have some of your emails and a listener voice clip. And you're going to want to hear that voice. All right here on the Aviation News Talk podcast. And now let's talk about the very best way, the absolute best way to load an instrument approach when you're receiving vectors to final. And sadly, like many things in aviation, the answer is, well, it depends. Now, I thought we'd talk about this as I've recently flown with a couple of pilots who really struggled to load instrument approaches using the Garmin G1000 and using the Cirrus version called the Perspective. In some cases, it caused them to fail the phase checks that I was giving them. In other cases, they were able to eventually get an instrument approach loaded properly, but it took several minutes to accomplish what could have been done in a few seconds if they were more knowledgeable about using the G1000. Now, as a pilot, your goal should be mastery of the airplane. And just as you strive to master other aspects of flying, such as making really great landings, I want you to aspire to knowing how to use your avionics really well. I'm sure you take pride in making great landings, and I want you to also take pride in knowing how to use your avionics. One of the most common issues I see occurs when pilots are receiving vectors to an instrument approach. If you're not yet an instrument pilot, this means the pilot is receiving a series of turns from ATC that eventually lead them to joining the final approach course at about a 30-degree angle. Often, when I see a pilot flying an instrument approach with vectors from ATC, the pilot is confused about whether to load the approach with vectors or to load it with an IAF. And sometimes they don't understand the reasons why they were taught to do it one way or the other, and in which situations they should or should not load the approach using vectors. In one case, we had just flown an instrument approach and the published missed, and we were getting vectored back to fly the same approach again. In that situation, I would have simply pushed the PROC key, selected Activate Vectors to Final, and the Enter key, and we would have been all set up to fly the approach again. Now, you might be thinking, but I was never told to load an approach with vectors, but was told to always load an approach with an IAF. And indeed, that may make sense in some situations, but it totally depends upon which Garmin GPS you're using, and to some extent, what the terrain is like that you're flying over, as I'll explain in a few minutes. But here's what happened on one flight. We first flew the ILS-29 right at Stockton in an aircraft equipped with a G1000 NXI. After flying the first approach, the GPS was giving guidance to the missed approach hold at Orang. We needed to fly the same approach a second time, and instead of simply activating vectors to final, the pilot reloaded the approach using the IAF at IPDU. Now, IPDU is the final approach fix, so to start the approach there, you would have to fly a procedure turn. But even if you were to load an IAF while getting vectors to an approach, you wouldn't want to choose this particular IAF. Instead, you should choose an IAF that gives you the longest, straightest line to the airport. Later, you would then activate the leg of the approach that the controller was sending you to. To do that, you'd put the cursor on the second of the pair of points that define the leg, and then press the menu key, activate leg, and the enter key. But the pilot had bigger problems. Although he reloaded the approach, he never activated any leg of the approach. So unfortunately, the GPS was still giving guidance to the hold at Orang throughout his approach. Had he looked at the HSI course pointer, he would have seen that it was not set for the inbound course of 294 degrees. Or if he looked at the moving map, he would have seen that the active leg, the one in magenta, was the hold. But he continued to fly the vectors he was given, even though he had no course guidance for joining the approach. Afterwards, he said that he likes to reload each approach from scratch, and that probably works well for him in older Garmin GPSs. In earlier versions, the G1000, and in all Garmin 430s and 530s, loading a new approach always wiped out everything from the last approach. But this was a real problem when you were flying the missed approach hold of one approach and then loaded a new approach. Because once you finished loading the new approach, the missed approach hold that you were flying is wiped out. And now you have no course guidance to use for continuing to fly the missed approach hold as you wait for instructions to begin flying the next approach that you just loaded. With these older versions of the Garmin G1000 and the Garmin 430-530, savvy pilots learned that while they were in the hold, they could start to load the next approach, but they shouldn't make that final press the enter key until they started getting vectors from ATC for that next approach. As soon as they got the initial vector, they could press the enter key, which loaded the next approach and wiped out the hold that they had just finished flying. But lots of pilots are unaware of that issue, and I've seen many of them accidentally wipe out the hold we were flying because they loaded the next approach. Fortunately, Garmin caught on to this problem, and now newer versions of the G1000 and Cirrus Perspective solve this problem by retaining the hold of the prior approach when you load the next approach. That way, you can still continue to get course guidance for flying the previous hold, even after you fully loaded your next approach. The downside is that to fly the next approach, you need to activate some leg of the new approach or activate vectors to final. Otherwise, you'll continue to get course guidance to the missed approach hold, which is what happened with this pilot when he loaded the approach the second time. Now, the FAA requires that anytime you're on a localizer, that you use the localizer signal from your navigation receiver for course guidance. You can't just continue to display and fly using the GPS needle. So with the G1000, once you join the localizer, you need to switch the CDI from the magenta GPS needle to the green localizer needle. This pilot continued to fly vectors and turned inbound to join the localizer, which of course wasn't displayed on the map, but he didn't switch to the green needle until he was at the FAF. As soon as he did that, the localizer was showing a full-scale deflection, as we'd had no primary guidance for joining and tracking the localizer. Of course, that was a bust for this particular phase check. Afterwards, the pilot told me that he was taught to never load an approach with vectors and to always load an approach with an IAF. So let's talk about why some CFIIs have said never load an approach with vectors and to always load an approach with an IAF. That was great guidance for older Garmin GPSs, but it's no longer necessary for newer versions of the Garmin equipment because the problems we used to see with loading an approach with vectors no longer exist in these newer systems. So these days, I'm often loading an approach with vectors in situations where in the past I would have loaded an approach with an IAF. So let's talk about when and why to load approaches with an IAF and when to load them with vectors. First, there are two generic ways you can fly an instrument approach. One is to fly with pilot navigation, also called pilot nav or own navigation. And when you do that, you're going to be directed to fly first to an IAF. That's the initial approach fix, which is the starting point for an instrument approach. And some approaches have multiple IAFs. If you happen to be in a non-radar environment, which means in an area where they can't see you on radar, pilot navigation is the only way that you can fly an instrument approach. Now, the other way, which is the way we were talking about, is to fly with vectors. And in the real world, that's the way most airlines will fly an instrument approach. The controller will issue a series of turns called vectors. And ultimately, that series of turns results in an aircraft joining an instrument approach at an angle less than 30 degrees, somewhere along that approach. So flying with vectors results in a fairly gentle join as an aircraft gradually merges with one of the segments of the instrument approach. And generally, that join occurs somewhere inside the IAF, or in other words, it joins at a point that's closer to the airport than the IAF, and that can shorten the distance an aircraft needs to fly an instrument approach. By the way, there's a third way you can fly an instrument approach, which allows you to, under some conditions, fly directly to the IAF or the intermediate fix, which is generally the next one you'd come to after an IAF. And once you're cleared direct to the IAF, a pilot can then follow the instrument approach on his or her own. In order to start an instrument approach at the IAF, you must be in a radar environment, and the turn to final must be less than 90 degrees. If the turn would be more than 90 degrees, ATC must first vector you further away from the airport until you're outside the IAF, at which point they can clear you direct to the IAF, as the turn at the IAF will now be less than 90 degrees. So to review, a pilot can fly an instrument approach via ONAV by flying to an IAF or an IF, or by flying an approach via vectors. Now let's talk about where the wrinkle comes in, especially with older versions of the G1000 and with the Garmin 430-530, of which there were more than 100,000 of these units sold since 1997. With these Garmin navigators, loading an approach is relatively simple, though the choices a pilot has to make when loading the approach can be a little confusing, especially if you're planning to fly the approach with vectors given by a controller. When loading an approach, there's a point in the process where you must choose one of the following. Either you choose one of the IAFs for the approach, or you choose the word vectors, and then you hit enter and continue loading the approach. If you're flying via own navigation to an IAF, loading an approach is simple. Just look at the chart, choose an IAF, and then load the approach using that IAF. Or, if you're flying an approach by getting vectors from a controller, you might think, well, of course you should choose vectors when you're loading the approach. And with new equipment, you can do that and it will work just fine. But it's not always the best way to load an approach, especially with older software versions. Let's take the Garmin 430-530 as an example. Historically with these systems, when you loaded an approach with vectors, most of the waypoints associated with the approach dropped off the moving map in the flight plan, and you were left with just two points being displayed, the final approach fix and the missed approach point. Now for non-instrument pilots, the missed approach point in an instrument approach is the last point that you pass over just before you land. And the final approach fix is that next to the last waypoint in the instrument approach. And just to review, when flying via own navigation from an IAF, a pilot will start at the IAF, the initial approach fix, and then fly to the IF, the intermediate fix, then to the FAF, the final approach fix, and then to the missed approach point. And you will see all of those points if you load an approach with an IAF. But if you load an approach with vectors, with older versions of these systems, you'll see just the last two points. And those two points are probably sufficient for flying with vectors if you're flying over relatively flat terrain. And by the way, I hasten to mention that Garmin is located in Kansas, and Kansas is arguably one of the flatter states in the U.S. So I think the engineers can be forgiven if they originally felt that they only needed to show the last two points when flying an approach with vectors, because indeed, if you're over flat land as you're being vectored, you can safely stay at the same altitude until you reach the final approach fix, where you would then start your descent down to the minimum altitude permitted on that approach. However, if you're flying in hilly country or mountainous terrain, approaches may have multiple step downs after being vectored onto the approach, and it becomes very difficult to figure out if the controller is vectoring you at a safe altitude if you can only see the last two points of the approach on your moving map. And to be fair, gradually over time, Garmin added some additional points for some instrument approaches in these older systems, so that you would in fact see more than just those two waypoints when flying vectors to an approach. Now, a great example is the localizer runway 28 left approach at Monterey Regional Airport on the Monterey Bay in Central California. That approach comes in over the mountains, and those mountains rise to over 5,000 feet, and there's a series of five step downs to get down to the minimums for the approach. Now, let me describe it for you. It starts at Charlie, which is a combined IAF slash IF with a 1-minute holding pattern at 6,100 feet. From there, A pilot would descend to 5,400 feet until they reach Yeetude, and then descend to 4,600 feet at Rodney, the final approach fix. From there, you would drop to 4,060 feet at Wuxian, and then to 3,020 feet at Zilku. And then finally, you drop down to the MDA, or minimum descent altitude, of 1,860 feet. Now, it's been a while since I've flown this approach with a Garmin 430, but I remember that in later versions of the Garmin 430 that at least three waypoints were displayed for this particular approach, not the minimum two waypoints displayed that you used to get when you loaded an approach with vectors. But here's the problem. Imagine I'm receiving vectors from ATC, and I've loaded this approach with vectors, and I can just see the last three waypoints. Now imagine that I'm being vectored at 5,000 feet, but I can't see Charlie, Yeetude, or Rodney on my moving map. So as I'm being vectored onto the approach, it won't be obvious to me whether the controller is bringing me inside or outside of Yeetude, and if I'm a properly paranoid pilot, and I am, who always tries to verify that ATC has me at a safe altitude, I really need to know if I'm inside or outside of Yeetude, because if I'm inside Yeetude at 5,000 feet, I know I'm at a safe altitude, because the minimum altitude for that segment is 4,600 feet. But if I'm being brought in outside of Yeetude at 5,000 feet, the minimum safe altitude is either 5,400 feet or even 6,000 feet, depending upon how far outside Yeetude the controller is vectoring me onto the approach. So if I can't verify my location on the moving map because I loaded the approach with vectors, I'm going to be a pretty nervous pilot. And I might in fact be asking the controller what the MVA, or minimum vectoring altitude, is in this particular area. Now, there is a way to know my distance out on the approach, but it's a lot more work than just glancing up at the screen and seeing the names of the waypoint on the map, which I would see if I had loaded the approach with an IAF. When I load an approach with vectors, most Garmin receivers will give me the distance to the FAF, the final approach fix. But now I'm going to have to do a little math. I need to look at my chart and find the distance for each of the segments. So, for example, Rodney is the FAF, and the segment from Yeetude to Rodney is 3.1 miles long. So if my distance to Rodney displayed on the Garmin is more than 3.1 miles, now I know I'm outside of Yeetude and that I need to be at 5,400 feet or more. And the segment before that from Charlie to Yeetude is 2.9 miles long. So if I'm more than 6 miles away from Rodney, I'm outside of Charlie, and now I know I need to be at least 6,000 feet. But you can see this adds a lot of mental math. So now you can see that with older GPS navigators and software versions, loading an approach with vectors creates some problems, as not all the waypoints are displayed on most of these older GPS receivers. And the common workaround has been to instead load the approach with an IAF, even though the controller is giving you vectors to the approach. Then you have to figure out which leg you'll be intercepting and activate that leg before joining it. Overall, that method is more complicated and more prone to error than simply loading an approach with vectors. And it is counterintuitive to not load an approach with vectors, since you're being given vectors to final. But with these older systems, that's what you have to do in order to get more waypoints on the moving map and in your flight plan. And in the past, that's exactly what I would do when flying an approach with vectors from ATC with these older systems and software versions. I'd look on the chart for an IAF that would produce the longest, straightest path to the airport and didn't include a procedure turn. Then I'd load the approach with an IAF, even though I was being given vectors to the approach. Now that does two things for me. First, it puts all of the waypoints for the approach on the moving map, so I can clearly see where I am relative to each of the waypoints. Plus, I'll now see the distances listed for each leg of the approach. So I no longer have to do all this mental math trying to calculate my distance from the final approach fix to figure out which fix I'm inside or outside on the approach. And then I'd wait to see exactly where along the approach the controller looks like he or she was going to be bringing me in. I won't always know immediately where that is, but over time it'll become clear if, for example, they're going to bring me onto the approach somewhere between Yeetude and Rodney, or perhaps a leg earlier than that. And once I can see that ATC is bringing me onto a particular segment, in this case where the minimum altitude is 4,600 feet, I then know that I'm safe if I'm being vectored at, say, 5,000 feet. And when it's clear to me which segment they're bringing me onto, I'll press the FPL key, the flight plan key, to open up the flight plan. And then I will activate the leg of the approach that they're bringing me onto. To do that, I put a cursor on the second of the 2 points that define the leg, and that's going to be the point that's closer to the airport. So in this case, if the controller is bringing me in between Etude and Rodney, I'd put the cursor on Rodney, the second of the pair of points that define the leg, hit the menu key, and activate leg will already be highlighted for me. And then I'll hit the enter key. This now makes that leg of the approach magenta on the moving map, and I can now get the autopilot to intercept that leg for me, and then have the autopilot continue to fly the approach from that point on. So in summary, if I'm flying over flat country and I'm getting vectors to an approach, I'll load the approach with vectors. But if I'm in mountainous terrain, or I have an approach with a lot of step-down points, and I'm using an older Garmin 430, 530, or an older G1000, I'll load the approach with an IAF instead of vectors so that I can force the GPS to display all of the waypoints on the moving map. Then, as I figure out where the controller is bringing me in, I'll activate that leg of the approach that the controller is vectoring me toward. Now, there is one exception to all that, and that's when I'm flying an approach in a Cirrus perspective, which would be Cirrus aircraft built since about the middle of 2008, or if I'm flying with a Garmin G1000 NXI, which came out around 2017 in Diamonds and Cessnas, or if I'm flying with a Garmin GTN 650 or 750. All of these newer systems use a different algorithm, so that when you load an approach with vectors, you actually get virtually all the approach points displayed on the moving map. So that solves the problem of knowing where you are relative to the waypoints that wouldn't otherwise be displayed on some GPS systems. However, there's still one little gotcha, and that is that even in the perspective and the Garmin G1000 NXI and the GTN 650 or 750, it still displays the distance to the final approach fix, and not to any of the fixes that might still be between you and the final approach fix. Now, this can be very misleading to pilots who glance up and think that the distance displayed is to the fix in front of them, when in fact it might be to a couple of fixes further down the instrument approach. Regardless, with these new systems, when flying an approach with vectors from ATC, I feel very comfortable loading approaches with vectors, when in the past I would have loaded an IAF and activated a leg. Now, it's totally up to you as to how you want to load an approach, but at least now you know the reason why in the past many CFIIs had to load approaches with an IAF instead of with vectors. And you know why doing so isn't really necessary anymore if you're flying with later model equipment, such as the Garmin G1000 NXI, Cirrus Perspective and Perspective Plus, or the GTN 650 or 750. And here's a quick update from Robin Stanley.
G'day, Max. This is Robin, one of your Patreon supporters from Australia. Couple of good news stories. First of all, I'm about to do my 15th IPC instrument proficiency check. Here in Australia, we have a private and we also have a command instrument rating. Just to challenge myself, I do the command instrument rating each year in my SR22G6. The other really good news story is my son. I got him into aviation and he's just finished his Boeing 787 Dreamliner endorsement and he's starting to fly internationally from Australia. By the way, I'm now junior pilot. Thanks, Max, for all you do and thanks for making me a safer pilot.
Robin, thanks so much for the update. Congratulations to you and your son. And also, all I can say is, what a great voice. We Americans love these Australian accents, though I know you don't have an accent. It's us that have the accent. But thanks so much for the update. And if you'd like to leave a recording as Robin did, it's very easy to do. Just go out to aviationnewstalk.com, click on listener question, leave your question or comment, and it'll be delivered to us through the SpeakPipe app. And speaking of updates, a month or two ago, we mentioned that Dan Morris had wrote in. He said he is in Louisiana, and he mentioned that he lives in a flight school desert and that he might think about starting his own flight school. So we asked if anybody had some experience, and sure enough, we got an email from Stacy Aldstadt, who said that he had recently helped someone start up a flight school. And so we got the two of them connected, so hopefully we've made a good connection there. And here's an email from patron supporter Sam Dawson talking about episode 299. He says, I agree, illness can be insidious in its effects. Many years ago, I was flying an MH-60 helicopter, which I think is a Black Hawk, though it depends on the service you're in. They also have the Seahawk and the Jayhawk for the Navy and the Coast Guard. Flying over the Rockies at night, I noticed something was off with my flying and told the other pilot. The next day, I came down with a mild case of the flu. I think the combination of the flu and the high altitude really affected my flying, and my body thought we were much higher due to the hypoxic effects of having the flu. Some great inputs in episode 299. I like the idea of doing limits and emergencies once a month. Another thing I do is break down the systems of my aircraft and review two a month. If there is an applicable system in the GA airplanes I fly, a 172 and a PA-28, I go over those as well. I volunteer as an instructor with the local NIFA flying team at the U.S. Military Academy, where I primarily do annual training and simulator training with cadets. I decided this weekend before flying to have the pilots go through the drill of an engine failure before we started the engine. Rather than just say and touch, I had them move the switch or lever. I did limit the number of times they moved the fuel selectors to limit wear and tear on these. This seemed to be very helpful. We could do the drill of air fuel spark for the relight several times in a minute, then followed with fuel spark to shut down the engine. It was also helpful for them to actually pull out the checklist after doing the memory items and find the engine failure procedure. Sounds good, Sam. Thanks so much for that. And here's an email from listener Reed Leonard regarding episode 301. And that was the Cessna 340 crash that failed to fly the circle to land properly in San Diego. He says, I think you're spot on. Asking for the visual 2-3 would have made the difference. We get so tracked into what ATC is giving us that it takes a mental reset to ask for different. Breaking out, if for some reason not wanting the opportunity to practice the circle to land, I'd likely have canceled IFR, but had not thought to request the visual. So that will be top of mind going forward. Thanks. And I wrote back and I said, Reed, the episode really made me think about how I teach IFR. For circle to land, we're always on the approach all the way to the airport. So I need to make sure that I make a point of pointing out these two different ways that you can break off the approach early and still fly to the airport. And my thanks to Thomas Dorrell, who we had on the show here a few episodes ago. He wrote to me, a big part of military traditions are to present the commander's coin for outstanding performance and duty. Please accept my coin in my last command. Your podcast and ecosystem of GA information has made all of us better pilots. It was an honor to be your guest on episode 299. All my best, Tom Dorrell. He sent along a very nice challenge coin. Tom, thanks so much. And I just want to mention that the ranking of podcast jumps around quite a bit from day to day, but I took a look last week and pretty much for the entire week, we were number one. So thank you so very much. The way we become number one is when you tell your friends about the show and encourage them to subscribe or hit the follow key. So thanks so much for supporting the show. And Aviation is such a small community. See if you know any of these people who've signed up in the past month to support the show via Patreon. They include Douglas McCree, Geraldus Smith, Chris from New Zealand, Charles Rapalier, Lou Nowakas, Michael J., Brick Linder, John Wickware, Mark Alford, and Eric Martin. And also thanks to these Patreon supporters who edited their pledge up to higher amounts, and that includes Deb Gangwish, Christopher Cole, and Brendan Schock. And also thanks to a one-time donation from Richard Benson. He's donated before. He donated via PayPal and says, hey, Max, it's been a while, tight purse strings this year, but on this Tuesday of giving, as far as all the individuals we share with, you're my choice today because you consistently give without expectation. Richard, thanks so much. That's very kind of you. And if you'd like to help support the show, as these people have done, it takes just a few minutes to do it. So take a moment now, go out to aviationnewstalk.com/awesome, where you can sign up on our Patreon site and specify the dollar amount that you'd like to donate each month. And you can also see the goodies that you'll get. Or you can go out to aviationnewstalk.com/PayPal to make a one-time donation, and you don't even need a PayPal account to do that. And I do read some of your emails on the show. If you'd like to send me a message, just go out to aviationnewstalk.com, click on contact at the top of the page, and that's the absolute best way to send me a message. And if you're in the market for a new headset, please consider buying a Lightspeed headset and using one of the links in our show notes, because when you use those links, they will donate to help support the show. So until next time, fly safely, have fun, and keep the blue side up, and remember that you can always go around. You can.